Rebels were gunned down on Thursday by Wake Forest Randolph Childress, game winner. To rebound, Duke has to get big plays in the middle from Cherokee Parks and Mr. Everything Grant Hill. Today, the Blue Devils' road runs through University Hall and the Virginia Cavaliers, a team that beat them twice last year. This time, though, the Cavaliers won't have their leader and star point guard, Corey Alexander. He can only cheer on his teammates from the bench due to an injury. Junior Burrow has helped to keep the wins coming in Charlottesville, but Burrow isn't alone. A strong supporting cast with freshman sensation Harold Dean. It'll be rocking in University Hall as Virginia looks to keep its win streak alive and Duke tries to get back on the winning road next. And welcome to University Hall on the campus of the University of Virginia for today's game with second-ranked Duke and the Cavaliers. Hi, everybody. I'm Tim Brand along with Dan Bonner on a cold Saturday afternoon. And it's fun to be here because the Cavaliers have surprised everybody on top of the standings in the Atlantic Coast Conference. And Duke being ranked second in the country coming off a loss. Take us through the four keys, will you, Dan, especially for the University of Virginia?
During Virginia's six-game winning streak, defense has been the story. They've got to do the job on the defensive boards, and they have to score consistently. For the Duke Blue Devils, they've got to be tough. Virginia's as tough a team as you'll ever want to see. And in addition to that, they've got to get some production from their big three. The big three, of course, are Grant Hill, Cherokee Parks, and Antonio Lang. You can see what they did during Duke's undefeated 10-game run to start the season. However, the other night against Wake Forest, Parks and Lang in particular had poor games, although Grant Hill stepped up very big. However, a tripod can't stand on one leg. Cherokee Parks, one of the country's best centers, really struggled. This was typical of his night. There he gets knocked out of bounds and goes over the bleachers. We mentioned Grant Hill with a big game last year's National Defensive Player of the Year. He's shown some great offensive skill. He's going to be a lot for the Cavaliers to handle.
Now, we mentioned Corey Alexander will not play. He's out with an injury. He thrived on this pressure defense against Duke last year, 35 points in the two wins, and they have had great success with Corey. What about the supporting cast that we mentioned?
Well, Virginia's done it without Corey Alexander, and a big part of the reasons are right here. Harold Dean, the freshman, starting at point guard, Jason Williford, Uri Barnes. Virginia's effort has really been a team effort. These guys have been valuable. Here, Harold Dean with the defensive pressure. This is a young man at point guard, gets up and dunks it very easily. He had a great game against Clemson with 19 points. Also against Clemson, inside right here, Uri Barnes, not very tall, very strong. Here he had a career-high 17 against Clemson. And you talk about Virginia's team play. There's Jason Williford circled. And he's going to pass the ball and cut through the lane. And watch at the end of this play, number four, Junior Burrow, passes back out to the top, sets the screen down inside, and Jason Williford hits the jump shot. For Virginia, Tim, it's been team play all the way. They get a lot of guys to touch the ball. They move the ball well. This ought to be fun.
Physical defensive ball game, I suspect.
No question about it. They all are between these two teams.
All right, my kind of game. When we come back to University Hall, we will hear from Corey Alexander. Stay with us. It will be rocking in Charlottesville. University Hall already rocking on the campus of the University of Virginia. The reason, second-ranked Duke is in town. And welcome back to University Hall. You know, we talked about Corey Alexander, the success he's had in the past. Well, Dan had an opportunity to sit down and talk to Corey earlier today.
Thank you very much, Tim. We're here with Corey Alexander. And Corey, we want to know from you, what is the word on that ankle?
Well, we're not exactly sure yet. It's a situation we're going to go in and x-ray on this Wednesday, and then, you know, Dr. McHugh will give me some type of notice from then, and we'll not be able to get out and run around again.
Now, in terms of getting out and running around, you're in that cast there. Are you able to do anything physically to try to maintain your condition?
I'm able to run in a swimming pool. It's a deep swimming pool, which doesn't allow me to put weight on the bottom of my foot, but it allows me to get some exercise in, some cardiovascular exercise, something that I had gotten away from for a while because I had a plaster cast on and wasn't allowed to get in water. So, I mean, I'm just happy that I can do something now and try to get back in a little bit of shape.
Now, Corey, can you do anything with the basketball in terms of shooting or anything like that with your cast?
Well, I've been working on my range. I've been shooting from a chair and from a rolling stool, just running around the basketball court. I'm somewhat annoying my coaches, but still, you know, just getting a little something in with the basketball. It's kind of hard to stay away from it for so long.
Well, I understand that. You know, even if it doesn't help your game much, you'll just be a bear when you play horse with somebody.
Yeah, I'm beating them now already. So I mean, nobody else can do that yet. And I think I might be the champion horse by the time I come back to play.
Now, Corey, I know it has to be very frustrating for you to sit and watch your teammates play, but comment, if you would, about the way the fellas on the team have played in your absence.
I think they played really well. I mean, I think they went through a spell at the beginning of the season where they were kind of shocked that I wasn't out there. And I think the guys have been kind of used to me being there with them playing. But I think after they got over that, they've been playing well. They've won 6 games straight, and you know, they're doing a really good job. They're getting contributions from everyone, and if they continue to play like that, I think they'd be very successful.
Now, what do you think they need to do to be successful this afternoon against the Duke Blue Devils?
It's going to be tough. I mean, Duke's going to be mad over the loss of Wake Forest, and you know, I think they're going to be, you know, ready to play when they come in here. But I think we can beat them. You know, I mean, it's just going to take a little bit more from us and a little more effort for us to get this win today.
Well, Corey, thank you very much for being with us. Best of luck to you.
Thanks a lot.
All right, we'll be back with the starting lineups after these words from our friends at Bud Light.
Raycom and Jefferson Pilot Sports present the best in college basketball, the Atlantic Coast Conference. Today's game is brought to you by U.S. Air, Nations Bank, Discus Athletic, MCI, Food Lion, Ford Mustang, Bud Light, and by Nationwide Insurance.
And welcome back to Virginia, everybody. The second-ranked Blue Devils come to town. Virginia on a roll, 6 wins in a row. Tim Brand along with Dan Bonner today. And Dan talked about Harold Dean in that situation. I think one of the matchups that's going to be fun is Cornell Parker and Grant Hill.
Cornell Parker and Grant Hill are two of the best defensive players in the country. And I don't know that we'll see them matched up against one another on both ends of the court, but it ought to be entertaining. They can both really get after it.
How much of a psychological advantage is it, do you think, that Virginia's had such great success in this building against Duke in recent years?
I don't know that when these two teams get together, there's any psychological advantage on either side. Both of these teams have traditions of tough, hard-nosed basketball, and I think whoever can be tougher and have harder noses usually comes out on top.
Sounds like my kind of game. Hey, let's take a look at the starting lineups. And first, we'll have the starting lineup for Duke: Grant Hill, of course, Antonio Lang, and Cherokee Parks. We talked about those. Then you have Chris Collins and Jeff Capel. Capel, the freshman out of Fayetteville, North Carolina. For the University of Virginia, Junior Burrow, Jason Williford, Yuri Barnes in the middle. Now, he is not a big guy. Yuri Barnes is 6'8", 231 pounds. Then, of course, Cornell Parker and Harold Dean. So there are the starting lineups. Duke 10-1, Virginia 9-3, 3-0 in the ACC. And we'll have the opening tip for you when we come back to University Hall in Virginia. Participation by the crowd here in Virginia, looking for the type of game that Virginia has played, and that is keeping opponents to 34% shooting. A couple of quality coaches here today as well. Duke has Mike Krzyzewski, as you know, 4-time National Coach of the Year, 10 straight NCAA tournament appearances for Coach K and his Blue Devils. And at the other side for Virginia, of course, you have Jeff Jones. Been here 15 years as a player and a coach, quality guy. Became head coach when he was only 30, and he developed a very successful program here.
And I think that Jeff Jones, one of the truly underrated basketball coaches in this country. This is his fourth season. His teams have been to the NCAA tournament twice. His team won an NIT championship. And I tell you what, to make the adjustments that he and his staff have had to make after losing Corey Alexander, and to have his team in the position where his team now finds themselves, I think says a tremendous amount about that young man's ability to coach basketball, and he doesn't get near the credit that he deserves. He's really emerging as one of the very, very fine coaches in basketball.
71 wins for Jeff Jones against just 38 losses. You saw the series. Virginia has won the last two. You see how they did while you were here in the 1970s, 10-10.
Well, that's not too bad. Of course, I can sit and watch. I watched a lot of those games.
We're all set. And Virginia will have it first. This is Harold Dean, the freshman, 6'1", 169-pounder.
Man-to-man by Duke, and very interesting matchup. Grant Hill going inside to guard Yuri Barnes.
That comes out to Pearl. Here's Parker.
That's going to force Antonio Lang to play a bit more on the perimeter on the defensive end.
Inside they go, the turnaround. Big rebound by Lang.
Duke wants to get the ball out and run with it.
Collins pushes it. No whistle, no foul. Turnover number one for Duke. And here's Parker.
Didn't get a chance to see it, but Parker was matched up against Grant Hill on the other end.
Junior Burrow, offensive, his first, the team's first.
That's pretty good defensive strategy by the Duke Blue Devils. You have Grant Hill play inside against Yuri Barnes, and he's available for help. Right there as Junior Burrow beats Parks outside. Burrow takes the ball to the basket, and Grant Hill, who's playing an inside defensive position, has the opportunity to come over and help.
First minute of play now gone. No baskets scored by either team.
Burrow matched up against Antonio Lang, and there's a real problem for Virginia. Burrow picks up his second personal foul. We've played 1 minute and 2 seconds in this basketball game, and Virginia's leading scorer already has 2 fouls. Jeff Jones has to get him out of the game.
He picked up those 2 in a matter of 12 seconds, so Chris Alexander comes into the game replacing Junior Burrow. Chris Alexander, a 6'8", 216-pound sophomore from Long Branch, New Jersey. Here's Hill. And Duke is on the board. 2-0 Blue Devils.
Well, Junior Burrow got into early foul trouble against Clemson the other night, and Virginia was able to weather that storm, so they're going to have to do it again.
Jeff Jones trying to steal some time here with Burrow on the board. Duke Willard's shot is short. Big rebound underneath. The follow can't go. Alexander was the last to touch it, so it'll be Duke basketball.
Tim, it comes as no surprise that Virginia struggles shooting the basketball. They only shoot 40% on the year coming in. They're 0 for 3 today.
But you have to go all the way back, Dan, to last February to find a team that has shot better than 50% against UVA. This is Collins on the left elbow to Lang. His shot is hard. Parks with a rebound right over top of Alexander.
It's a tough matchup for Alexander. Parks is not only taller, he's also much stronger.
Penetration by Dean, and he's fouled out front. Foul on Collins, his first. Team's first.
I know that Mike Krzyzewski was concerned following the Wake Forest game, because at the end of that ball game, his team did some very non-typical Duke things, throwing the ball away, just weren't very tough down the stretch, and he knows his team has to be very, very tough today.
Dean, jump stop. His shot is hard.
Virginia hasn't really had a good look at the basket. Duke doing a nice job on the defensive end thus far.
Capel shot from outside, can't go. Here's Parker. Virginia 0 for 4 from the field. Trailing 4-0. Parker down the lane, has it blocked, and the foul. Foul will be on Capel.
Cornell Parker noted for his abilities as a defensive player, but watch him here with the basketball. The dribble move one way, drives Grant Hill away, creates a lane to the basket. Capel not there in time.
Cornell Parker at the line. He's a 68% free throw shooter. He's hit 32 of the 47 he shot this year. He makes the first one.
There's Junior Burrow seated on the bench. He got 2 fouls very, very quickly. You want to think about what Junior Burrow means to this team. Almost 33 minutes, 17 points, 9 rebounds a game. His Cavalier teammates are going to have to step up with him on the bench.
That's why we say right now Jeff Jones trying to steal some time until Burrow can get back in there. Parker makes them both. It's a 2-point game. Collins for 3.
Duke doing a very, very nice job setting screens on the inside, getting their guys open.
7-2 Duke. Jason Willis at the baseline. Nice shot.
Williford, a very experienced player. Didn't score a lot last year, but played an awful lot of minutes. That's a really tough matchup for Capel.
Hill's been quiet thus far. Collins. Crowd thought Lang walked. No call. Collins down the lane. Oh, nice move.
Collins used his body to protect the basketball from not only Harold Dean, but from Chris Alexander.
Blue Devils by five. Willard backs him right in with a little jump hook. And it's 9-6.
Nice job by Jason Williford to take advantage of that matchup.
Duke 4-for-6 from the field.
Man-to-man for Virginia.
Parks down the lane, off balance, air ball, and the follow and the foul. This foul will be on Uri Barnes. That's his first.
One of the keys to Wake Forest's win over Duke on Thursday night was the fact that Wake Forest was able to keep Duke off the offensive boards. That time, Virginia looked like they were in pretty good defensive rebounding position, but the air ball allowed Antonio Lang to get to it.
Chris Alexander goes out further to the Cavaliers. Sean Wilson checks in as Lang makes his first free throw and first point of the afternoon.
Sean Wilson is taller and stronger than Chris Alexander, and I think Jeff Jones was concerned about the fact that Cherokee Parks just seemed to be muscling his way against Chris Alexander, and so Wilson's in there to put some meat up against the body of Cherokee Parks.
11-6 Duke. 15:50 to go in the first half. Tim Brandt and Dan Bonner with you. Barnes. Good idea, poor execution. Turnover.
Wilson is not noted for his offense, and he was simply not looking for that pass. Ball almost hit him in the back.
This is Hill. Oh, nice move by Hill. Can't get it to go. Parks with the follow. Williford. And Wilson surrounded him, and I believe the foul will be called on Wilson. That's his first. Because Williford gets all ball.
This is two times down the court now. That's great defense by Cornell Parker, where Virginia hasn't been able to claim the defensive rebound. We talked about how defensive rebounding was going to be a key for the Cavaliers, and Cherokee Parks just had great position and was able to draw the foul.
Makes his first when he's a 75% free throw shooter.
Now Duke has gotten out to a 6-point lead, which is not a tremendous lead, but Virginia is not really a comeback team. They're like a football team that runs the ball a lot. They're fine when the game's close or they're ahead, but they have a tough time coming back.
Well, you mentioned underneath power basketball. Duke has 6 second chance points and lead 13-6. We'll be back after a word from our good friends at Bud Light. Duke leads by 7, 15:33 to go in the first half. Tim Brandt, Dan Bonner with you. And right now, Duke having its way inside. Look at Harold Dean, the freshman sensation here at UVA. He has been able to score in double figures the last 7 games. Take a look at all the freshman starters this year, or at least the standouts. It's been an impressive year for freshmen in the ACC, Dan.
Yeah, it has been. There's been some people who have come in. Obviously, Joe Smith from Maryland with the tremendous impact. But Tim Duncan getting an opportunity to play down in Wake Forest and doing a real nice job. And Harold Dean stepping into a tough situation and performing well here at Virginia.
How about Rasheed Wallace and McGinnis and Stackhouse down at Carolina?
Well, of course, that graphic there said freshman starters, and they don't start down in Chapel Hill.
This is Williford. Looks inside to Wilson, goes to him, over top of Cherokee Parks.
Great block out by Grant Hill inside. Virginia just not getting anything on the offensive board. Cable airmails that baby.
Reminder to stay tuned at halfback or halftime for the Volkswagen ACC Women's Report.
All right, I'm not going to use any more football analogies if you're going to do that. That's an extremely difficult shot by Cornell Parker. The Duke defense being very effective, staying between the Virginia players and the Virginia basket. Duke really all over the board.
What you were talking about, having their way inside.
That's a 5-second violation. That play just took much too long to develop.
Now that was a great job by Lang on the baseline, but also, more importantly, the 4 guys away, not letting anybody break open.
Tim, Virginia was not organized for their inbounds play at the point that the official handed the ball to Cornell Parker, and it took them 2 seconds before they got to their position.
Way outside by Collins. Rebound by the Cavaliers. Harold Dean pushes it.
Parks really playing off Wilson.
Back to Dean for three. Gets his own rebound. Nicely done. Last touch by Grant Hill. It'll be Virginia ball. And with Junior Burrow comes back in. Wilson goes out, just like you had speculated.
You just can't leave Burrow on the bench the entire first half. Junior Burrow now is going to have a very fine line to walk. He's going to have to play hard enough to be a factor in the game, but he's got to be careful that he doesn't pick up that third foul.
Cavaliers been ice cold. Over to Dean. This is for two. Fight for the rebound. Lang comes up with it.
Virginia's got to recognize what Duke is doing. Grant Hill matched up against Parker. There's a very bad play. Parks didn't know that pass was for him.
That ball was, I think, intended for Hill. Parks happened to be running in between the two. Here's Parker.
Now on a switch, Grant Hill is guarding Parker this time down the court. But the strategy inside is that ever guarding Uri Barnes goes and double teams Junior Burrow when Burrow gets close to the basket.
Cavaliers just 2 for 10 shooting, and here's another turnover. Williford Gentry pass couldn't be handled.
Virginia really, really struggling on the offensive end. This is something that they have done this season. Their defense has always bailed them out. We said they had to rebound the ball defensively. They haven't done a really good job at that. We said they had to avoid dry spells. They're in the midst of one right now, Tim.
Marty Clark comes into the game for Duke. Chris Alexander comes back in. Uri Barnes sits out for Virginia. 13-6, Blue Devils. Nice turnaround by Parks.
Parks has that NBA turnaround baseline jumper.
Taken away by Lang. That's 5 turnovers for Virginia. And Lang stepped on the out-of-bounds mark. Stepped right on the line.
It's really a break for Virginia. Dean makes the pass. Just too long a pass. And here Antonio Lang, he knows he's over there. His foot's on the line.
Look at his face.
There. He knows it, but he's hoping maybe he can get away with it.
Duke on a 6-0 run, 5 turnovers for the Cavaliers.
This is a great job. He's got to dribble the ball.
Under 13 minutes to play now, first half. Shot clock has not been a factor.
That's great defense. Just tremendous defense by the Duke Blue Devils.
Blue Devils stay on the run. Clark has it taken away.
Oh, what a ball handling exhibition by Harold Dean.
Dean makes it 15-8. Duke.
That ball was slapped away from him a couple of times, but he never quit on it. Ended up with a dunk.
That brings the crowd to their feet.
Virginia's relied on its defense all year long. It's got to rely on the defense now.
Lang shot off the back of the iron. Clark comes up with it.
Another offensive rebound for the Duke Blue Devils.
Inside to Parks. Alexander can't stop him.
Parks can use his size to get the position he wants on Alexander. He sort of got that Jack Sigma square up to the basket, fades away just a little. Alexander can't get it.
Parks now has 8 points. Burrow with the pump fake. Own rebound. Still can't get it to go down. And finally, the foul against Cherokee Parks.
You see what Junior Burrow means to the Virginia team on the backcourt. This is really some hard, hard work inside. Gets to the basket. Ball just doesn't go down. Now, I guess, yeah, I think everybody thinks this ball's in, but there's Burrow right back up again. Parks getting the foul. Burrow with 3 shots before he finally gets the foul. That really helps your offensive rebounding stats. Doesn't do much for the old field goal percentage, though.
That's the first on Parks. He now goes out of the ball game. Capel checks back in. Clark is in, along with Greg Newton for Duke. At the line is Burrow. This is it.
Virginia shooting only 66% from the free throw line on the year as a team, but during in their last 4 games, they shot almost 80% from the free throw line.
Burrow's not one of the better ones, though. 61% for the year. And he rolls this one in. So with 11:29 to go in the first half, Duke leads Virginia 17-9. And MCI proof positive instant replay.
Harold Dean with the defensive play right there, slaps the ball away. Now as the ball starts up the court, Newton hits it. Dean tries to get it. Grant Hill gets his hand on it, but Harold Dean gets the ball down the court for the layup. Proof positive that Harold Dean belongs in this league.
Right now, Duke offensively shooting 50%, better than most teams have done against Virginia this year.
Jason Williford for the Cavaliers, Tim, is 2 for 3. The rest of the Cavaliers, 1 for 10.
Here's Newton. Running one-hander won't go. Ball is tipped by Robinson. And last touch by Duke.
That's a great play by Chris Alexander to play. It was a two-on-one fast break, really, in miniature down along the baseline. And Alexander deked Newton, made Newton take a very tough shot.
Ball Robinson, another freshman in the game for Virginia. Here's Parker, has it knocked down.
Boy, Duke doing a great job.
They double down low, leave Alexander alone. He scores and he's fouled.
That's the first time that Virginia has taken advantage of the Duke defensive strategy. Grant Hill is inside, and what's Grant Hill? He just leaves his man to double team Burrow, finds Alexander, who powers it up to the basket. That's been going on the entire game. Anytime Burrow gets the ball down low, Grant Hill comes to double team. Alexander went to the basket. Burrow found him. Excellent play.
Foul on Newton, his first. Alexander goes to the line for the first time this afternoon.
That was a good catch by Alexander. Very powerful move to the basket. The young man you mentioned, very thin, only 216 pounds, but he got the ball up to the basket very effectively.
Alexander makes it, and it's a 17-12 game. Lead down to 5. Hill shot short, big rebound by Robinson. Nice entry pass, locked down. Barnes fights for it, jump possession arrow Duke.
You know, we talked about toughness in this basketball game. There was some hard-nosed play down inside. Barnes has good position, catches the ball. Parks is there. He gets help from Clark. There's the block shot. Watch these guys stay after the ball. That's called clamping your hands on the ball, not letting anybody have it.
Clark left alone. This is for 3.
Duke has been very efficient on the offensive end of the court. Good screens, good cuts, good passes. Very aggressive defensively. They're making it tough for Virginia to throw the entry pass.
Robinson picks up his dribble, gets into trouble. Parker helps him. Under 10 minutes to go now, first half. Robinson throws it away. No look pass. And I think Barnes looked where the fake was going.
No look, all right. Barnes wasn't looking.
This is for 2 for Lang.
Barnes playing off Lang, trying to help out inside against Parks. And Virginia, after that little run, they now found themselves down 10.
It's the biggest lead of the game for Duke. They double Williford and he loses it out of bounds.
I'm telling you what, Grant Hill is not guarding his guy inside. Anytime Grant Hill gets the opportunity to double team a man inside with the basketball, he's taking it. And with that one exception where Virginia got the dunk from Alexander, the Cavaliers have not reacted well to that strategy.
Frank Scagliata, the official, getting into it with a fan down at the corner here. 9:10 to go, ball taken away. Bob Burrow. Lang gets it back, pushing it down all the way. Nice pass to Parks. Toward the conclusion of our telecast, we'll be announcing the players of the game, all brought to you by Nations Bank. 24-12, biggest lead for Duke. It's a 7-0 run for the Blue Devils. Junior Junior Burrow from way outside, a three-pointer from Burrow. Oh, my. Van Bonner just shakes his head.
Yeah, you're struggling on offense. The ball doesn't go in the basket, so Junior Burrow goes out beyond the three-point line and just buries it.
Oh, nice drive by Clark. 26 to 15, Duke.
That's great hustle by Cherokee Parks. He did a nice job to knock the ball away.
I was concerned. He's so big. Running up behind Harold Dean, I thought he was going to roll up on Dean's ankle.
You know, Tim, here through the first 12 minutes of this first half, I get the idea that the Duke Blue Devils decided they were going to come in here and whatever else, they were going to play very, very hard, and they've done that. I think they've played harder than Virginia to this point. I think that's why they have the lead.
Here's Dean. Can't get a shot to go. He's getting the open shots over Collins and can't hit him.
That really wasn't an open shot, though, Tim.
He went
up
over
Collins into
though.
The lane, but Collins was right there.
26-15, 7:35 to go. Duke has led from the very beginning. Nice rebound by Burrow. No foul called. Cornell Parker knocked down by Lang. Lang called for the foul. His first.
Virginia runs the ball up the court here. They get away with a pretty lazy pass down on the other end, but once they get out on the break, they're very aggressive. Cornell Parker with a nice move to get around the block and to force the foul. Nothing has come easy for the Cavaliers today. Duke playing very aggressively on the defensive end of the court. There's Junior Burrow going to sit down again. Remember, he got two personal fouls in the first minute and 2 seconds of the first half.
Senior co-captain misses the front end. One of the top defensive players in the ACC, but at the line, he's a 68% free throw shooter.
Virginia thus far 29% from the field and 7 turnovers.
Parker makes the back end.
That's just not going to get it done against one of the top teams in the country.
Cuts the lead to 10. 7:20 to go, first half. It's been physical.
Leads it by 10, and one of the reasons is that Virginia has not done a very good job taking advantage of its opportunities. Here, Junior Burrow creates an opportunity, but then loses it, and then Antonio Lang takes the ball down the court. It's a 4-on-1, and Duke converts on its opportunity. Duke shooting 53%, 10 of 19. Virginia only 29%, 5 of 17. Virginia, as we mentioned, not a team that shoots the ball real well anyway. But during their winning streak, they've done a great job of holding their opponents down on that field goal percentage. So even though Virginia's been low, the opponents have been lower. Not so today.
Blue Devils' largest lead was 11 points. It's at 10 now with 7 minutes to go first half. Tim Brandt and Dan Bonner with you. Duke with the basketball.
10 seconds on the shot clock.
This is Capel. Good penetration blocked down by Burrow. Numbers aren't there for Parker. And they're going to call the block on Grant Hill.
Jamal Robinson was the guy, I think, blocked that shot, and he's now limping out there. Virginia's defense doesn't really deny the passes for you, but they really make it difficult for you to run your offense. There, as you can see, the physical nature of the play by Virginia. Now watch. Robinson with that big swooping motion knocks the ball away.
Alexander.
Alexander's done a nice job. Cherokee Parks has been more than he can handle down on the defensive end, but on offense, he's contributed a couple of baskets.
Capel gets caught in the lane.
That's a three-second violation.
Crowd called it before the officials did.
Well, I think home crowds generally count faster in those situations than the officials.
26 to 19, Duke. 6:14 to go. 8 turnovers for the Cavaliers, 5 for Duke.
Virginia got themselves down by 11 points. Now they're within 8.
six-game roll, six wins in a row, sitting atop the Atlantic Coast Conference standings at 3-0. Williford shot, a brick.
That's just a tough, tough shot. Antonio Lang in real good position.
Parks, five rebounds. Hills comes to the other side. Can't convert. Robinson.
Boy, he's been a factor in this game.
He's playing well. Dean loses it.
As we talked about Virginia wasting opportunities, Dean just couldn't handle that basketball. Virginia had a fast break opportunity. Instead, get their ninth turnover. Now we're going to get a foul on Antonio Lang with an illegal screen.
Good call away from the ball. Collins was left open.
Well, that's why he was open, is Antonio Lang was running interference in there. It's two fouls on Lang now. Now that's the seventh team foul against the Duke Blue Devils. So Harold Dean is going to get to go up the other end and shoot.
Cornell Parker checks back in. Dean goes out.
Well, Dean can't go out. He's shooting the free throw.
Yeah, but watch this. Robinson goes to the line, see if anybody catches him.
I thought it was Dean. Maybe it was Robinson. It's hard to pull something over on these officials.
You don't make mistakes.
Talk to my wife.
Can't get it to go. Lang with the rebound. 5:25 to go in the first half. 26-18 Blue Devils. Lang with the penetration. Did he carry it? The push.
Jeff Jones maintaining a very calm demeanor right here. Antonio Lang sees Barnes matched up with him out there. He heads to the basket.
That's the second on Barnes. Alexander goes out of the ball game now.
The crowd's upset. They thought that was a walking violation. However, that part of the reason he walked was the fact that Barnes was helping him across the lane.
Marty Clark checks in and Capel gets a rest for Duke. Good ball movement by Duke.
You've got to be impressed with Parker's quickness on defense. He just really stays after it.
Lang takes it back to the top and gives it up to Hill.
Hill's probably glad to see Robinson out there.
Here's Collins, who shows quickness.
Good defense by Virginia.
Junior Burrow with the rebound. He has four. Nice entry pass into Barnes. Followed by Burrow.
That ball just squirted out of the hands of Yuri Barnes, and it shot by Junior Burrow almost rimmed out.
4:30 to go first half. It's a six-point game.
Virginia stepped it up on the defensive end. That's exactly where Duke needs to go with the ball, but Barnes pushed him away from the basket.
Robinson to Parker for three.
That's not a good shot, I don't think, by Cornell Parker. Now it's Junior.
Jump ball, possession arrow, Virginia.
What a great play by Jason Williford to just hang in there. Mike Krzyzewski doesn't think it's such a great play. He thinks it should have been a foul.
He's hot.
There's the shot by Parker. Virginia not noted for its transition game. Parks battling. Oh, it's Yuri Barnes that ties him up. Barnes avoids the elbow and gets the jump ball, and Virginia gets the possession. Nice play.
Coach K still wolfing. Five straight points for the Cavaliers.
Well, as a coach, you always have to let the officials know that you're there. Robinson's played a lot of minutes in this first half.
And Wilson's back into the ballgame for Williford. Havlicek in the game. Shot clock at 10. Robinson checks it, now calls to his teammates. It's down to five. Robinson in the lane.
The shot was blocked.
Parks got a piece of it. They don't see that and give it to Duke. I thought he got a piece of it.
Even if he did get a piece of it, it's a shot clock violation.
That's
Duke's
right.
Ball.
26-20 is our score. We'll be back. Athletic Community Outreach Award winner is Grant Hill from Duke University. Grant is the chairman of the Read with the Blue Devils program, a reading incentive program for area third and fourth graders. He also spends time at Durham's Project Graduation Chairman to help high school graduates celebrate drug-free. Congratulations once again to our Discus Athletic Community Outreach Award winner, Grant Hill. And there's his dad, Calvin, right there. Quite a football player in his day, and now vice president with the Orioles.
Grant Hill was a factor very early in this game on the defensive end, moving off his man inside, double-teaming against Junior Burrow or whomever had the ball inside. Virginia did not react very well, and Duke got out to the lead.
Blue Devils lead by six with 3:22 to go first half. Here's Newton. Big lineup now for Duke. And Newton walked with the ball.
Credit that turnover to the Virginia defense.
So Duke now starting to struggle, turning the ball over. That's eight for the game for the Blue Devils.
Well, we talked about Virginia's defensive ability. There's Duke with nine turnovers, Virginia with eight. Virginia's defense is what has kept them in games. And Virginia's defense is what has keyed their 9-3 record.
Duke with eight, Virginia with nine. The announcers for this game selected and compensated by Raycom and Jefferson Pilot Sports. Any use of this broadcast without their express permission is prohibited. There's foul on Barnes, and that'll be his third.
Barnes gets position inside, but then just bulls his way to his basket. Newton was standing there. Just can't run the guy over.
Grant Hill, 1-for-4 from the field. First field goal of the game, and then none since.
He's matched up against Cornell Parker on that end of the court. Parker's as good as there is defensively. Cherokee Parks, though, has 10 points and 6 rebounds for the Blue Devils.
Trying to pick for Hill here. The lead is still 6. Park loses it.
You better grab one, because Parker was coming.
He could feel him breathing.
10 seconds.
Inside to Parks, and that ends a streak which went 5.5 minutes without a bucket for Duke.
It's pretty good if you can go that long without scoring and end up with an 8-point lead.
Williford picks up his dribble and throws it away.
Pass. Virginia just can't guard Cherokee Parks inside.
Lang takes it to the baseline. Kicks it out to Clark.
Good pass.
Collins left alone for three around the rim.
Well, that's great hustle by Cornell Parker.
Possession arrow belongs to Duke. Still great hustle by Parker.
Marty Clark fortunate that he didn't get a foul called him on that, in that situation. Parker knocks the ball away. Now watch Parker get on the floor here for this ball. Pulls it over, and there Marty Clark sort of jumps on top of him.
Parker landed, but caught the ball in the ribs.
Parker plays as hard as anybody you'll ever want to see.
2 minutes to go in the first half. Cherokee Parks way outside. Collins with a rebound. Kicks it to Hill. And Wilson gets the rebound.
Talked about Virginia squandering opportunities. Duke squandered a couple right there.
Virginia trying to cut the 8-point lead. With the ball in the hands of Parker, he's got it.
Good defense by Duke. Just very, very strong defensive effort by the Duke Blue Devils.
Shot clock at 4. They've got to go with it. Dean fires it up.
It's an air ball. It's another shot clock violation. That's 2 shot clock violations in this basketball game by the Cavaliers. Dean now 1-for-6. Jeff Jones wearing a look of concern, and you can certainly understand why.
Oh, I don't think there's any question. That's twice, as you mentioned, and they weren't even looking at the shot clock until Dean saw it with 5 left.
The Cavaliers' problems, they don't really have anybody that is that shot clock runs down can go and get his own shot.
Go, Tony.
Their offense is really a team-oriented one.
Hill has it blocked by Wilson. Under a minute to go, first half. Williford.
That's an
air ball.
Not a good shot. The guy was right in his face. Marty Clark may have gotten a hand on the basketball. Last couple of trips, Virginia has just exhibited almost no patience on the offensive end.
Clark running one-hander, fouled by Alexander with 30 seconds left in the half.
It's a very aggressive play by Clark. Virginia doing a pretty good job on the defensive end, but Clark just came around that screen full blast.
Eric Meek comes into the game, and Lang goes out with 30 seconds left. Clark at the line. Clark has hit 17 of his 20 free throws this year. Fundamentally sound player. His dad was a coach. And he rolls that one in.
His dad was a coach, and he seems to be a pretty well-adjusted kid anyway.
A 6'6", 205-pound senior. Duke 5 for 5 at the line today. He makes them both. So that pushes the lead back to 10 with a half minute to go.
Duke stays with that man-to-man defense, and it has been a solid, solid defensive effort by the Duke Blue Devils in the first half.
Shot clock is off, game clock at 12. Under 10.
So you're going to let Dean operate against Collins.
Off balance, and he hits it. And that brings the first half to a close. What a shot by Dean, the freshman. Interesting first half. We'll be back with halftime activities. 30-22 Duke.
Today's ACC action is brought to you by Pizza Hut, Ford Mustang, Food Lion, and by Nationwide Insurance.
To Jefferson's University, where Duke leads 30-22 over the Cavaliers of Virginia. And welcome back, everybody. Tim Brand along with Dan Bonner today. And the shooting, well, neither club really near 50% for that first half. It's been interesting.
We expected a defensive struggle, and that's what we've seen. I've been most impressed in the first half with the Duke Blue Devils' ability to get the ball inside to Cherokee Parks, to rebound the ball offensively, and to really disrupt the Virginia's offense down on the Duke defensive end of the court. For Virginia, though, as poorly as they've shot the ball, as many times as they've turned the ball over, they're only behind by 8 points. And so I expect that we'll have a very entertaining second half.
Well, you said it'd be physical, and to this point, it has been.
Certainly has.
Take time out now to look at this week's Nationwide Insurance ACC Scholar Athlete of the Week, and it is Uri Barnes from the University of Virginia. Barnes, a junior from Richmond, is a two-year letterman for Jeff Jones Cavalier Club. Uri has a 2.7 grade point average in psychology. So congratulations to our Nationwide Scholar Athlete, Uri Barnes, from the University of Virginia. We're at halftime where Duke leads Virginia 30-22, and we'll be back after this word from our good friends at Bud Light. Interesting, hard-fought first half. Duke leads 30-22, and I say interesting in that both teams shot poorly, but it was physical.
This is very physical. Virginia playing well defensively. I think Duke doing a great job defensively. Let's take a look at our U.S. Air halftime stats. You can see the field goal percentage. Duke missed 8 of its last 9 shots as Virginia's defense really kept it in the game because the Cavaliers have not been able to shoot the ball very well throughout. You can see Virginia doing a pretty good job on the boards. Those turnovers really hurt. The game has been very physical. Duke has done a nice job getting to the offensive boards. Cherokee Parks in particular with 12 points in the first half, 6 rebounds, including 2 offensive rebounds. The game has been physical down on the other end. Uri Barnes catches the ball as he takes the ball to the basket. Good help by Cherokee Parks. Junior Burrow, despite the fact that he picked up those 2 fouls early, finished the first half with 6 points and 5 rebounds.
Virginia has to feel good, shooting 29%, just being down to Duke by 8. We'll be back after a word from our good friends at Bud Light.
One of the largest discs.
And Jefferson Pilot Sports' exclusive coverage of ACC basketball is brought to you by Discus Athletic, Budweiser, Central Fidelity Bank, and by the Jefferson Pilot Life Insurance Company.
And we're back at University Hall. 30-22 is our score. Duke leads Virginia. Tim Brandt, Dan Bonner with you. Just about set to go here. We're underway.
I think it's very important for the Cavaliers, trailing by 8 at halftime, that they come out and establish something offensively early in the half. Harry Barnes did not score in the first half. He's had 17 against Clemson, 15 against North Carolina State, so he's been a key cog for Virginia.
Wasn't a whole lot of scoring in that first half. Here's Williford at the top. Kicks it down to Barnes. Barnes missed. Parker going down the lane. Burroughs loses it. Here's Hill with a nice look to Lang. And Lang can't handle the ball. Turnover. Cavaliers get it back and knocked out of bounds by Capel.
Looks like nobody wanted to handle the ball on that one. It kept bouncing around until it bounced out of bounds.
Duke has 10 turnovers. Virginia has turned it over 14 times in the game.
Each team's turned it over thus far in the first minute of the second half.
Parker at the right elbow to Williford. They whip it around. Burrow with a nice looking shot for two.
You can see what his absence meant to the Virginia Cavaliers. Boy, that was a big time shot right there.
Burrow with two personals, got those in a hurry. Had to sit down a good portion of the first half.
Cornell Parker's done an outstanding defensive job against Grant Hill. Hill only scored 2 points in the first half.
Man to man, they go down to Parks. He banks it in.
Now, Yuri Barnes has three personal fouls. Once again, there's Parks. He had 12 in the first half. Virginia wasn't able to find the answer.
Williford down the lane. Ball's loose. Beams on it. Takes it in himself. Banks it in.
We talked about Virginia and their toughness. Harold Dean just didn't quit on that ball.
He is a good-looking freshman. 32-26. Duke still leads. Capel to Parks. The foul by Junior Burrow. His third.
Jeff Jones very concerned. Junior Burrow and Yuri Barnes, both with three personal fouls. It's very difficult to resist the temptation to reach in there and grab at the basketball. Jeff Jones was telling his players, just get your hands up and try to make it a tough shot.
Thomas Harold Burrow now will have to be very careful. Parks at the line. And he makes the first one. He had big games at Iowa and Michigan, had 23 points and 9 rebounds against Juwan Howard.
He has got to play very well for Duke to compete among the elite teams in the country.
He was perfect at line today, but now he's 7 for 8. Capel kicks it out to Collins on the baseline. They double down on him, so he goes cross court. Oh, nice shot by Capel.
Duke is too good a basketball team. If you give them 3 opportunities, they're most likely to convert at least one of them.
That was Capel's first basket of the day. Duke's lead back to 9.
It's Grant Hill with the double team. That time he got called for a foul.
Jeff Jones hot about being all over him.
That's what Grant Hill's been doing. Whoever he's matched up against inside, eventually he leaves and comes over to double team. Look at Hill. He's just waiting to see which way Burrow goes. Now when Burrow goes, Grant Hill commits. Fortunately for Virginia, Hill fouls that time.
Hands everywhere. Parks with another rebound. He has 7. Inside they go to Lang, turn around and banks it in. Great looking shot by Antonio Lang.
He knows Burrow has 3 personal fouls and takes the ball strongly to the basket. Virginia now in that 11-point hole again.
Parker takes it on the baseline against Parks. Now goes with the left hand. Tough shot. Parks has another rebound. That's 8.
And Antonio Lang gets smacked. Hit in the eye.
That brings out the team doctor and Coach K.
We're gonna have a sub for him, okay? Yeah. Have a sub.
Great job, guys. I couldn't see whether he got elbowed in the eye, whether he got poked in the eye on that particular play. Jeff Jones taking the opportunity to talk to his team.
Antonio Lang, a tri-captain on the team. He leads the ACC in field goal percentage. Take another look.
Looks like he got poked in the eye. Parker was coming through the lane. He'll sit down. Newton will come in the ball game.
So it's Collins. It'll be Newton, Capel, Hill, and Parks for Duke.
We talked about the importance of Virginia coming out and establishing something offensively early in the second half, and they've scored 6 points, but just as with the start of the game, they've had problems on the defensive end, particularly on the defensive board.
Duke 37, Virginia 26, 16 and a half to go. Newton with the turnaround.
Alexander got a piece of that, but Virginia not able to control the ball, and out of bounds it goes.
Williford.
Can't fault the effort right there, but you've got to execute. When you block the shot, you've got to get it back.
It's a 5-0 run by Duke. Hill's been relatively quiet today.
Cornell Parker's been doing a nice job defensively.
Hill's been 1-for-7. Shot clock violation, turnover. Great defense by Virginia.
Duke didn't realize that after that blocked shot, the shot clock never reset because Virginia never got possession of the ball. They knocked a rebound out of bounds. Very correctly, the shot clock did not reset. Duke acted like they had a whole 35, and they didn't.
And Duke's bench didn't recognize it to help. Here's Williford at the top of the key. Junior kicks it out to Williford. Back they go. Over the big guys.
That's just great defense inside by Duke. Parks holding his ground. 9 rebounds now for Cherokee Parks.
Lead is still 11 for the Blue Devils. Here's Capel at the top. Now goes to the right elbow, but whistle away from the ball.
And a foul is going to be called against Newton with the push inside. Mike Krzyzewski not overly thrilled with that particular call.
15:54 to go. Duke leads by 11. We'll return after this word from Schick. ACC basketball coming your way tomorrow. Florida State takes on the Wolfpack of NC State tomorrow at 2 o'clock right here on the ACC Basketball Network. 37-26 is our score. Duke has led from the outset. 15:54 to go. A look at Antonio Lang, who was poked in the eye, but he has been attended to, and they say will return. As a matter of fact, during the timeout, walked over to Coach K and said, "Coach, I'm all right."
Got a quick glance at Marty Clark sitting on the Duke bench. Clark had 7 points for the Blue Devils in the first half.
Antonio now goes to the scorer's table, so the next dead ball, he'll check in. Junior Burrow's shot is short and rolls in. Hit the front of the rim, got a kind roll.
Excellent ball movement by Virginia. Duke's defense was not able to disrupt Virginia's ball movement on that particular occasion.
Cuts the lead back to 9. This is Hill to Collins.
There's Parks working for position inside.
Newton on the ground, takes it all the way down the lane. Wow.
Pretty aggressive move by the freshman.
And he was fairly emphatic with it.
He got his head and shoulders around Junior Burrow. Burrow had to be careful that he didn't foul. He walked.
That's another turnover. That makes 15 today for the Cavaliers. Under 15 minutes to play.
Talked about Newton. His play inside, he sets the screen. Now as he goes to the top of the key, notice how Burrow jumps up in the air. You can't do that to a guy that still has his dribble. Newton sees it, goes hard to the hoop. Nice play by the young man.
Newton moves well, 6'11", 220 pounds. Here's Parks, nice pass to Lang.
Lang walks. Lang did not anticipate the pass by Cherokee Parks, and the ball sort of bounced off his nose, and I think that's what he's telling the official as he walks down the court.
Donnie Gray says, shuffle those feet.
He's telling him he never had the ball. Duke now with 14 turnovers, so we've had a total of 29 turnovers in this game. We've had more turnovers in this game than Virginia has points.
It's a scary statistic.
But their defense has been very impressive. Virginia just can't get its offense going.
Here's Dean with a crossover into the lane.
Nice pass.
Oh, that was nice, and Robinson makes it a 9-point game with a bucket.
When Virginia has been able to isolate Dean against Collins, Dean's been able to get to the basket.
Hill
for two. Grant Hill scored the first basket of the game, and that's his first basket since that time. That's his only his eighth field goal attempt and his second basket.
Pushes the lead back to 11. Last touch by Hill.
So Grant Hill, Duke is leading in the ball game by 11, and Grant Hill went almost 27 minutes without scoring a point.
If you're a Virginia fan, you have to like the way Dean and Robinson have reacted as freshmen. Here's Clark with a rebound.
Virginia really plays hard. They play well defensively, but this isn't a game where you get points for defense. Eventually, you have to be able to put it in the basket, and the Cavaliers just have not done so.
Parks walks. And that brings Coach K off the bench. Reminder to stay tuned for the Nation's Bank Players of the Game Award. Nation's Bank will contribute $1,000 to the Atlantic Coast Conference Postgraduate Scholarship Program. Since 1971, contributions to the program have helped fund postgraduate educational opportunities for over 50 deserving student athletes. Duke leads by 11, 13-14 to go in the game.
A lot of dribbling in the Virginia offense. There's Grant Hill finding the double team early. And Virginia's offense is not an offense that consists of a lot of dribbling. When they're playing well, they're passing the ball without a lot of dribbling, but Duke disrupting the passing lanes, and Virginia just can't get it going on the offensive end.
This foul will be called on Alexander. You talk about that, and that pressure man-to-man has always been Duke's best defense. And Corey Alexander always had great success by attacking it on the dribble, and they haven't been able to do that with Alexander out.
Duke has been able to exert very good pressure on the basketball, and your point about Corey Alexander is a very good one. Alexander was a tough guy to pressure with the basketball. There at Virginia with no rebounds in this half.
Mike Powell checks into the game. Yuri Barnes comes back in as well, carrying three fouls with him. Robinson on Clark. And the foul will be called on Robinson. That's Clark, his first.
Clark had a real solid offensive game against Wake Forest on Thursday night, and he has continued with that offensive effort. We mentioned he had 7 points in the first half, and he's just recently come off the bench in the second half, but he's come off the bench very aggressively.
And we saw earlier he's a fine free throw shooter. Came into the game hitting 17 of his 20.
See his numbers on the game.
Nice player. He's helped this club through the years. He now has 8 points, three rebounds, three blocks. You know, Hill, Lang, and Clark have won two national titles. The senior class at Duke, 100 wins and 18 losses.
It's getting down to the time when Virginia is going to get going. They got to get going. They're down 13 points. That's the biggest Duke lead of the basketball game.
Here's Clark. We talked about him. Ahead to Capel. And he misses the dunk. And I'll tell you, Mike Krzyzewski doesn't like that at all.
He goes in and shoots the layup or dunks it straight in. I think he scores two. But what he does is he tries to do the over-the-head dunk. There's Clark, we're just talking about him, the good defensive play. Now watch him, he turns around, he's going to try to do the 360 here on the dunk. And that's why he misses it. He's not particularly happy about that play. Capel trying very hard to concentrate on the free throw and not look over at the dunk.
The freshman will learn.
And we talked about the turnovers in this particular basketball game. We've had a total of 28 field goals, Virginia and Duke combined, and now we have a total of 32 turnovers. So we've had more turnovers than field goals in this game.
You know, Jeff Capel was the Capital Classic slam dunk champion. I think he tried to show a little of that here.
Well, he does that very many more times, and his coach is going to slam dunk him.
And he misses the second one.
So he tried to get fancy and he cost his team a point, and you never know. Virginia doesn't appear to be any offensive threat at the moment, down 14.
Which, as you mentioned, is the biggest lead of the game. It's going to be called against Clark. Hill was trying to get him for walking, but Clark fouled him first. That's the first on Clark.
Again, as you watch the Virginia offense, watch the offense with the understanding that the Cavaliers normally do a very good job passing the ball, everybody handling it, moving the ball with the pass. However, Duke is cutting off those passing lanes, Virginia doing a lot more dribbling than they would like to do.
Minutes to go in the ball game. And last again, touch by Duke.
Junior Burrow with the basketball. Grant Hill running at him to try for the double team. Somebody's open in there, but the Duke pressure has simply been so good that Virginia can't find the open man.
Here's Parker, tries to get it inside. Can't do it. Gets help from Robinson. Nice pass to Barnes, and he has it blocked by Parks.
He didn't catch it well, or he'd have had a dunk.
That's the second foul on Parks.
Again, a lot of dribbling by Virginia, but Robinson with a nice job here penetrating in. Now, Barnes just simply isn't ready to catch the ball. He catches that ball. It's a dunk. Maybe it's an opportunity for a three-point play. Draws the foul from Parks.
Barnes worked into the rotation as a sophomore. Last year, he got better every time out, continues to improve. 6'8", 231-pound junior.
But that's his first point to the basketball game. We showed you before the game, he comes in averaging almost 10, and that's his first point of the game.
Duke with 11:45 to go, and we'll be back after a word from our good friends at Budweiser. Mention how much they miss him. He had 35 points in the two wins against Duke last year, and they miss his attacking dribble against his man-to-man pressure defense.
And see what he did against the Duke Blue Devils, 15 the first time, 20 the second. Virginia won both of those games, and for the season last year, 36 minutes a game, almost 19 points, almost 5 assists.
Broke that bone in the first game. When does he come back? You talked to him before the game.
He really doesn't know when he comes back, and I think that's one of the frustrating things both for Corey Alexander and the Virginia coaching staff, is they're going to take the cast off on Wednesday and take a look at it, and then they're going to decide what kind of a cast they're going to put back on, what they're going to do with it.
Here at University Hall, 11 and a half minutes to go in the game. It's a 12-point lead for Duke. Virginia has shot very poorly, but hung in because of their defense and physical play. Inside the Parks with the turnaround. Such a nice shot. She called it an NBA jumper. He now has 17 points.
Cherokee Parks is going to play big. 17 points, 9 rebounds today. Duke is a very, very difficult team to beat.
Parker with the running jump shot. Hill with the rebound.
Virginia just not getting anything within the context of its offense.
Duke gradually pulling away. Here's Capel. Rebound Barnes ahead to Parker. Had Robinson on the right side, waited a little bit too long. Robinson misses the shot. They say it was last touch by Cornell Parker, Duke basketball.
And again, Jeff Jones' club just can't get the ball to go in the basket. Duke did a nice job getting back and defending that fast break opportunity. So even though Robinson had a short opportunity, it wasn't an easy one.
Antonio Lang shot too hard. Barnes with another rebound.
You just can't keep coming down the court on the offensive end and coming up empty.
As we approach the 10-minute mark,
that ball bounced off the foot of Uri Barnes. That was very nearly a turnover.
Every possession now will become very critical for Virginia. Here's Parker inside. And the basket by Barnes.
Nice job to put the ball in the hands of Uri Barnes. If you're going to attack inside with Barnes, Grant Hill can't go any place to double team. That's Barnes' first field goal of the game.
He has struggled. Cuts the lead back to 12.
Of course, he's been in foul trouble. Duke has tremendous size on the interior.
Barnes has three.
You know, Tim, Duke has 4 to 6 points, and at the point per minute pace that Virginia's on, they're only going to have 40 in the game.
Lang shoots with one on the shot clock and drains it.
So Virginia's really got to pick up the offensive pace. They're scoring about 1 point per minute, and if they only get 40 points in the game, they may as well pack it in because Duke's already got 48.
Cavaliers' low this year was 39 against Connecticut. 9:21 to go. 48-34 is the score. Foul is on Robinson. That'll be his second. Capel will go out of the game for Duke. Collins comes back in. Collins, a nice player. Obviously, his dad, nice career in the NBA, and coached the Chicago Bulls.
Yuri Barnes again taking the seat on the bench. It's just been sort of a lost afternoon for Yuri Barnes. Played very, very solid basketball the entire season, but just hasn't been able to get it going today. Cornell Parker also out with a blow. There's Harold.
Taken away by Dean. 48-36. Duke. Under 9 minutes to play.
Crowd trying to encourage a run from the Cavaliers.
Hill inside the Parks, kicks it out to Clark. Running one-hander is good. Clark now has 11 points.
Solid game by Clark.
Williford with a crossover. This foul's going to be called on Clark.
And now for Virginia. Noted for their defense. They've really got to pick up the defense. They can't afford to trade baskets anymore. We've talked about the physical play in this basketball game. A lot of bouncing around in there. The good pass to Lang, and that's just a very sweet-looking shot.
It was a tough shot.
Can't
with
defend
one,
that.
With one on the shot clock.
That's why he takes a shot like that, falling away. Has to.
Here's Williford.
Duke now playing zone.
Nice follow by Barnes.
Duke in the zone defense didn't find Barnes to block him out. But again, Virginia the last couple of minutes has traded baskets with Duke, and when you're down 12 with 7 minutes and 50 seconds left in the game, you cannot trade baskets.
Duke spreads it a little bit. 7:40 to go in the game.
Well, Duke with the 12-point lead. They're going to try to run some clock.
Melt the clock. Shot clock right now at 10. This foul will be called
on Jason Williford with the hand check against Granville penetrating to the basket.
That's his first. Situation is this, 7:28 to go in the game. Duke leads Virginia 50-38. We'll be back. Now for the Pizza Hut delivery of the game.
Virginia's had a difficult time getting inside the Duke defense the entire game, but Cornell Parker delivers a perfect pass to Yuri Barnes. It's our Pizza Hut delivery of the game, and Virginia needs more deliveries like that quickly.
As a point of emphasis from what we've been saying, Duke just 19 for 40 shooting today, 47%. Take a look at Virginia, 15 for 43, just about 35%.
Duke's defense has really disrupted the Virginia offense, and while the Virginia defense continues to be good, as it has been most of the season, the Duke kids have really hung in there. They've made some tough shots.
7:15 to go in the game. This is Granville again. They spread it out in an effort to melt the clock.
You don't really have to score any more points. They've got a 12-point lead. That foul by Virginia gave Duke the opportunity to have the 35-second clock reset.
Shot clock now at 5. Here's Capel, his shot. In and out. Fight for the rebound. Cavaliers come up with it.
Now Virginia's got to get the ball down the court, and they've got to score.
Inside to Barnes. And it's good by Alexander to cut it to 10 with 6:40 to go.
Yuri Barnes matched up against Capel. I thought that was a mistake on a switch, but not, no, it's not. Barnes has matched up with him all the way down the court.
Here's Hill. Turnaround jumper too hard. Rebound, Virginia. Ball's loose, Clark on the ground. And it's going to be Duke basketball. Wild.
It's the kind of game that these two teams play when they play one another. Grant Hill with the shot. Pretty good defense by Virginia. Clark gets his hand on the ball, keeps it alive, and then he's able to try it. He tries to get it to Grant Hill. Virginia knocks it out of bounds, but Clark actually saved that ball.
Great job by Clark not to touch the baseline with that left foot.
He was just trying to get the ball. Got knocked down inside. He hoped nobody stepped on him. Then the ball came to him, and he had the presence of mind to try to kick it to a teammate.
Alexander and Barnes go out of the game. Come back into the game as Burrow.
Georgia Tech getting hammered. Maryland Wake in a tight one. Those are two teams who I think are much better than people expected after the way the season started, particularly for Wake Forest.
Hill frees up on Parker, can't get it to go. Fight for the rebound. Cable gets it back to Hill.
That's been such a problem for Virginia early in the game at the start of the second half, and now when they absolutely have to have the ball. Great defensive effort, but they haven't been able to finish it by getting the defensive rebound.
Grant Hill now just 2 for 10 from the field. Here's Collins. Shot clock at 11.
The Duke scores on this particular possession. That might be all for Virginia.
Collins for three.
Here's another offensive rebound.
Collins for three again. And he drills it.
They had four opportunities, and finally they get the three-point basket. And Virginia may not be able to recover from that. A real nice defensive stand, but they can't get the defensive rebound. And your defense doesn't stop until you have the ball.
Collins, 23 of 61 this year from three-point range. Here's Dean, way outside. Parks with another rebound. He now has 11.
Well, it's all uphill from here for the Cavaliers.
Still have 5 minutes to play, but Duke in complete command, leading by 13.
For Virginia, they played solid defense. Duke missed three shots before they finally got the fourth one to go.
Pump fake by Parks, and he makes the jumper. Parks now with 19 points. Nice ball game by the big guy.
Virginia doesn't have time to do a lot of playing around. Collins with the slap away, but Williford picks it up.
Tough shot. Williford is just drilled by Cherokee Parks, and he's hurt.
Actually, the person who hit Williford on the head was Junior Burrow. Burrow scrambling after the rebound. I think got him right on the top of the head with his elbow.
See if we can get another look at this. See if it's Junior.
That's good defense by Duke. Williford has no shot in there at all as he comes up. Watch Junior Burrow come down. And Junior Burrow actually locks arms with Grant Hill, and it's Grant Hill's arm that actually hits Williford, but it's Junior Burrow that brings that arm down across Williford's face. Looks like Williford got it in the cheek. And his left cheekbone with Grant Hill's elbow.
Pretty good lick.
Chris Alexander, number 30, will be in for Jason Williford, number 22.
I'm not sure physical is the word we want to use.
Physical's as good a word as any other. It certainly hasn't been dainty.
Brutal. This is the largest lead of the game for Duke, 15 points, 4:31 to go. Barnes on the baseline, a little jump hook. And they'll spread it again.
We talked about Virginia being a team that was, their offensive structure makes it very difficult for them to score a lot of points quickly. So a comeback is going to be very, very difficult. The second half, Duke has 6 offensive rebounds, and that matches Virginia's rebound total.
Nice pass and blocked down by Robinson.
Alexander with a great block shot. Here's Robinson on the run. Robinson draws the foul from Grant Hill. He shows some athletic skill.
Grant Hill a little bit shaken up, hit hard. Grant Hill has struggled offensively, but never do you see a lack of effort.
We talked before the game about how Duke needed big games from its big three, and Cherokee Parks is the only one who's had a big game. However, the overall Duke team defense in limiting Virginia to 40 points through a little more than 16 minutes of the second half. We've only got 3 minutes and 54 seconds left in the game.
Robinson now 9 for 12 from the line this year. And he rolls that one in.
Duke's defense limits Virginia to 42 points, 36 minutes. It's tough to beat that.
3:54 to go. We'll be back after this word from our good friends at Budweiser. Look at the MCI proof positive instant replay.
And I think this was a key play in this basketball game. Duke trying to hold the ball. Cherokee Parks getting the rebound. That was the third offensive rebound in that sequence, and shot number four on that possession results in a three-pointer by Chris Collins. Cherokee Parks with a big game for the Duke Blue Devils. And you can see what Duke has done on the backboards. Just a tremendous rebounding effort by Duke. One thing you have to do against these Duke Blue Devils is keep them off the offensive boards. Virginia hasn't been able to do it in the second half.
Chris Havlicek checks in for the Cavaliers. 55-42 Duke. We have 3:40 to go in the game. Obviously, the Blue Devils in no hurry. Shot clock at 15.
Virginia trying to apply the defensive pressure. They've got to get some steals.
Shot clock at 5. Here comes Capel. They may not get this shot off. They don't. So they used every bit of the 35 seconds. It brings the game clock down to 3:18.
And that, I think, is the key, Tim. Duke has a 13-point lead. They really don't hurt themselves that badly by having a shot clock violation on that sequence because they ran 35 seconds off the clock.
Cavaliers really can't waste any time here. They've got to make up some points in a hurry. Thus far this afternoon, they haven't been able to do it. Three-pointer around the rim, Burrow with the follow. It's good, and he's fouled by Parks.
And that is not a good play by Cherokee Parks. In that situation, leading by 13, it doesn't hurt you if Junior Burrow scores the two. You can't give up the three-point basket. They don't, but now as Burrow gets the ball, Parks picks up the foul, so Burrow's got the opportunity for a three-point play.
So Burrow goes to the line, trying to convert the three-point play. He'll have one. Trying to cut the lead to 10. It's a 10-point game with 3:06 to go.
Virginia's not out of the ball game yet. That was a big three-point play by Junior Burrow.
Chris Alexander checks back in.
But Virginia's going to look to foul now if they can't get the steal right away. And so Burrow's got to come out of the game because he's got three fouls. He can't afford to foul out.
This foul called on Dean. That's his first.
That's the seventh team foul against Virginia, so now you're in the bonus, the one-and-one bonus situation for Duke.
No more fouls to give. The lead is 10, 2:57 to go in the game, and Collins goes to the line. He's a 67% free throw shooter.
Now Burrow coming back in the ballgame because you want Burrow down in the offensive end. You don't want him in there committing fouls.
For Duke, it's Lang, Collins, Parks, Clark, and Hill. He makes the first one. I know Doug's watching on a satellite dish in suburban Chicago. Not only did Doug coach the Bulls, but his son was a ball boy.
Well, he has the coach, he certainly ought to be able to be a ball boy. I'll be able to use those contacts in some way.
.240 to go. Lang working on Williford. Here's Clark.
And that offensive rebound play stings Virginia again. Collins now missed that second free throw, but you've got the offensive rebound. Collins drills another three. That's 3 3-pointers for Chris Collins.
Great range. Here's Parker. Has it blocked down.
That Duke defense just won't go away.
No foul called on Parker, but it will be the Cavaliers' ball.
Jeff Jones very, very upset. Wants to know why there wasn't a foul call on that play.
Crowd started to leave University Hall now, 59-45. Cavaliers about to get their first conference loss of the year. Clark with another steal. And he's fouled by Harold Dean.
Clark has really had an impressive basketball game.
Tell you what, I like Harold Dean, too. He's part of that Fort Union connection.
There's Clark with the steal there. Robinson just not able to come up with the ball. But watch Dean catch up to this play. That's great speed by Harold Dean. Good discipline by both of those young men. You know, how many times do you see it when the kids square off? Clark knew that Dean wasn't trying to hurry him. He's just trying to hustle.
Marty Clark, another one of those guys from Midwest, not in Illinois. Bangs this one around, and he comes back out on it. Yuri Barnes comes in. Burrow goes out. Clark, 11 points, 4 rebounds, 3 blocks. Trying to get another one on the board, make it 60 even for the Blue Devils. He does, and it's 60-45.
Virginia's got to get the ball up the court very quickly. They're limited to the 3-point basket almost now.
Good quick move by Dean. And Parks with another rebound. Jared Keith Parks with 14 rebounds today. What a game he's played.
Boy, Dean almost came up with a steal. Clark takes advantage of it and gets right to the basket.
You know, Dan, I'm not sure there's any good time to play Duke, but the worst time could be after Duke loses. Virginia's catching them at a bad time. They came in, as you said, really ready to play.
Well, one of the keys to this game, I thought, was what kind of toughness that Duke was going to exhibit against Virginia. Very tough group of kids. You can see Duke has been as tough as you want.
Great play by Collins. Clark is fouled. Oh, what great hustle by Chris Collins.
And that's exactly what I was talking about. How tough is Duke going to be? Well, I'll tell you what, they've been equal to the task there. Watch Collins knock this ball away. Dean thinks it's going out of bounds, but Collins simply doesn't give up on it. Down he goes. That's just a great, great play. Look at him. He's not giving up on it. Dean stopped. He thought the ball was out of bounds, and then here comes Clark.
I don't know if you saw the end of that, but Coach K called him over to the bench, gave him 5, and then gave him a great big bear hug. That's the kind of basketball Mike Krzyzewski loves.
There's Virginia continuing to struggle. 32% for the game. Duke up near that 50% mark. 47% is as well as anyone has shot from the field against Virginia this entire season.
And you have to go all the way back to last February. It's the last time a team shot 50% on Virginia. So they force you into that kind of play. Grant Hill goes out. He struggled today.
But the Duke defense was just better today. Virginia, who has as tough a group of kids on his basketball team as any team you'll see in the country, I think was just out tough by the Duke Blue Devils today. Duke really came in here after a very difficult loss on Thursday night against Wake Forest. Duke really came back very, very strongly. Stood up to the pressure that the Virginia defense was able to apply. Did a nice job on the offensive boards early in the basketball game, early in the second half, and early in the second half, and then late in the game when it really counted.
Parker with a shot at the top of the key, got his own rebound, showing great hustle. And then made the save. It'll still be Virginia ball.
There's Clark coming out of the basketball game. Fine game by that young man.
He's a nice player. He's contributed all the way through in his career. Parker with the pump fake and the dish. And Williford converts.
Williford came into the game averaging in double figures. That's only 6 points for Jason Williford. You know, we talked about Duke's big three and how they needed big games from their big three. Well, they've gotten big games from 3 guys, not the 3 guys that we talked about. Parks with 19 points, Clark with 16 points, and Collins.
1 minute remains.
Real strong game. He's in double figures as well.
1 minute to play.
Collins has 12.
Meek fights for it. Jason Williford gets it back. The pump fake, he converts and scores. That makes it 64-49. Under a minute to play. You're wondering about the Maryland Wake Forest game at 61-58 Maryland over Wake. Williford with another bucket. 64-51 with 39 seconds left.
Virginia just doesn't have enough time in this basketball game. You have to credit the Cavaliers. They haven't quit.
They've run out of time. Collins with a pass to Wallace in the finish. Collins has played an outstanding game. Air ball, last touch by Moore. Virginia ball.
That's the point that I was making, Tim. They've gotten real solid offensive games from three people. Cherokee Parks with 19, Marty Clark with 16, Collins with 12. Grant Hill only scored 4 points today. But Duke's able to overcome that.
Grant was just 2-for-10.
Cornell Parker is a pretty tough defender.
That's for three, and it's 66-54. 20 seconds left. Virginia gets it back. For three more.
Well, Virginia helping the stats, but there's only 15 seconds left in the game.
Robinson's shot makes it 66-57. 14 seconds left. No, but it shows no quit in the Cavaliers.
Oh, this Virginia team is not going to quit. You know, I'm sure Jeff Jones would have liked to see the ball go in the basket like that through most of the game.
Collins again gets it out to Beard. It's a 3-on-1. Mike has cleared his bench, and Beard has a tough time handling the ball. Joey Beard, just a freshman, 6'9", 225 counter from Ruston, Virginia.
Considered one of the top high school players in the country last year, and Duke continues to get that kind of talent in its program.
Robinson. I believe they called the block on Meek.
Well, there's a lot of fellas in there that could have called it on, absolutely. Stan Brunson, number 31, is the guy who got the foul.
Marty Aronoff, our statistician, scrambling to see who number 31 is.
Mike Krzyzewski over there with two freshmen, Capel and Newton, making a point.
Got 2.5 seconds remaining, and Robinson at the line. Mike does have their attention, doesn't he, at all times?
Well, with his team, he's a lot like E.F. Hutton.
A couple of outstanding coaches here today, and certainly quality individuals. And that'll do it. So Duke goes to 11-1, 3-1 in the conference. Virginia 9-4, 3-1 in the conference. We'll be back with some final thoughts right after this. Stay with us.
ACC action has been brought to you by USA, Nations Bank, MCI, Chick Tracer, and by the Jefferson Pilot Life Insurance Company.
So Duke gets his third conference win, 66-58, the final here. Dan Bonner, tell us about your final thoughts about the game. It was, as you said, a physical, sloppy game. Neither team really shot that well.
I was really impressed with two things. I was impressed with the defensive effort by Duke, and I was also impressed with the play of Cherokee Parks. Duke and Parks in particular were just very, very tough in this particular basketball game, and that's what led Duke to the win.
Take a look at the players of the game, brought to you by Nations Bank. Cherokee Parks, 19 points, 14 rebounds. Junior Burrow, 13 points and 7 rebounds. Remember, Junior Burrow got into foul trouble early. He had to sit a good portion of that first half. So Duke led all the way. We'll be back right after this. Stay with us. Duke beats Virginia this afternoon, 66-58, to go to 3-1 in the conference, 11-1 overall. For Dan Bonner, I'm Tim Brandt. Thanks, Marty Aronoff. You've been watching exclusive coverage of ACC basketball on the Raycom and Jefferson Pilot Sports Network.
Forest. Determined to show that was aberrant behavior, the Devils were in Charlottesville this afternoon where they had it going on. Jeff Jones had quite a task to keep Duke from making it two in a row. Blue Devils trying to get going early on. Chris Collins in the lane 13-6, Duke up on top. Antonio Lang looking better. That ankle must be feeling much better. The jumper goes. Duke rolling. Then Tony with some very nice D here, taking the ball away from Junior Burrow. He reverses the field, is on a 4-on-1 break to Grant Hill to Cherokee Parks, who finishes off with two of his 19 points. Virginia tries to stay in it. Harold Dean, nice shot to end the half. Devils up by 8 at the break. Duke keeps coming in the second half. Jeff Capel with the runner. Blue Devils go on to win this one by a score of 66-58. They improve to 3-1 in the conference and 11-1.
Well, Wake whacked them at Cameron Indoor on Thursday, and Virginia was waiting in Charlottesville today. The Cavs carried a 6-game winning streak into this one. Virginia playing well early. Harold Dean on the steal and goes all the way to the hole. Duke answers with a rally. Grant Hill, Cherokee Parks finishes the break. The Cavs were trailing at the half. Second half, Cherokee Parks providing a second chance for Chris Collins, and Duke goes up by 13. Jason Williford gets hammered by his teammate Junior Burrow. He'd go to the bench and he would be alert and okay, but the result wasn't so okay for Virginia. The winning streak stops at 6. Parks scores 19 points, pulls down 14 boards. The Blue Devils.
Good results, I think, for college basketball. The start of practice October 15th, and we're going to some exemptions for different tournaments, but the issue that was most disappointing that did not pass was the scholarship issue. Mm-hmm. We had hoped that the scholarships could go back to 14. 2 years ago, they were at 15. Now they're at 13. And I think all coaches and would like to have that extra scholarship. It denies a lot of opportunities for kids. And it just good for the game, too, because teams have a chance for a little bit more leeway, more development of kids. If a kid got hurt, the kid is academically ineligible. You know, things like that. It gives you a much more leeway to produce a good product. And, you know, that's what we're looking for, to have people produce good products.
Absolutely. We'll talk about that a little further as the show progresses. We're also going to take a look at some of the games that Duke played this week, as well as our feature on Eric Meek this week. And it's all straight ahead on Inside Basketball with Duke's Coach K.
Inside Basketball with Duke's Coach K is brought to you by your local Toyota dealer. I love what you do for me, Toyota. By First Union. At First Union, when it comes to service, everything matters. By Gatorade, it's all you're thirsting for. By McDonald's. By S&K Famous Brands. By Nike. By your Carolina Chrysler Plymouth dealer. See your local Carolina Chrysler Plymouth dealer for their best deal today. By Kingsdown, handcrafted mattresses since 1904. And by Payne Weber. We invest in relationships.
Black coaches. It influences the National Association of Basketball Coaches, which all the people who are coaching in the ACC, all the coaches throughout the country are members of the National Association of Basketball Coaches. Yeah, I'm sure that you've seen in the papers many things about what was being discussed, what's the main point, and the scholarship issue of not getting a 14th scholarship for men's basketball. Was the key issue, or really the issue that really frustrated a lot of coaches, especially the black coaches, who look at it as a denial of opportunity. And I'm sure that you realize that in your own lives that when you have opportunity denied, it's a frustrating situation. When opportunity is denied to youngsters, that's even worse. And so it was our way, and the Black Coaches Association's way, of saying, hey, this is another one of the many things that have gone against college basketball over the last 10 years, legislation which we feel has hurt the game, and now it's really hurting the youngster specifically. Because 2 years ago we had 15 scholarships, a year ago 14, and now we're down to 13, and it's just not the direction that college basketball needs to go, especially since these, what has not been publicized is the fact that the Coaches Association has made concessions in the last 3 months to cut out off-campus scouting, to cut down the number of evaluations, in other words, to cut down the finances, which would then create resources to provide that 14th scholarship. And certainly we can look at even other ways of doing that. Coaches can come up with innovative ways to do it. We would rather have the scholarship and cut in other areas than to deny that opportunity. As a board member of the National Association of Basketball Coaches, this past week has been an unbelievably busy one. We've had conference calls every night. In fact, at midnight for three consecutive nights, well into the morning, and then throughout the day, to make sure that we were working with the BCA and still working with the people that we'll have to work with for forever, and that's the administration of the NCAA, the college administrators, our school presidents. I personally have met with Tom Butters a few times, our school president, President Cohan, and the commissioner, and so it's been very hectic. I'm very pleased that there will be no boycott. The one thing that I'd like the public to know is that the coaches really never wanted players to be involved, and the NABC did not want players to be involved, but you never know how those things escalate. And to have people step in and put an end to the boycott or postpone it is really a great step for college basketball. Hopefully now we can get the people who are who should be involved to sit down and discuss these matters, and to have a keener interest in what it's going to take to keep our great game going in a very positive direction. And we certainly appreciate the help of all the people in the ACC to bring that about. And we've worked well together in the past, and I'm sure we'll do it again in the future. And we'll be back in just a minute.
Bonjour, class.
A three-game week for the Blue Devils, including two Atlantic Coast Conference games. It started out with a win over Brown on Monday night at Cameron Indoor Stadium. And now with four Atlantic Coast Conference games under your belt, Coach, I know in the games before Christmas and even some afterwards, you were still looking and doing some fine-tuning with your lineup. So has the rotation pretty well been established now?
Well, I think because of the young nature of some of the kids on our team, I don't know if that rotation will stay the same throughout the season, but I think what we've tried to do is, especially with the loss of Kenny Blakeney, that's a big loss because Kenny would be in that rotation, is try to establish Chris Collins and Jeff Capel and Marty Clark out there at the guard spots with Grant going back and forth, and then give a big look with Eric Meek and Cherokee Parks at times. Greg Newton can come in, mm-hmm. and then, of course, Tony and Cherokee would work mostly together. And those eight kids would comprise the top eight right now. But, you know, we're looking for other guys to come along. It's tough once you get at the conference to go too much further than that. I thought during the weight game, Marty Clark did a really good job mm-hmm. for us. He got big buckets, led the break a couple times, and gave us some enthusiastic play, and we didn't have as much during the whole weight game. Certainly in the second half, he was he made big free throws down the end. I thought that the two free throws that might have won the game for us, and but did a nice job. He was very active. I thought that Grant Hill also was very good. He, in fact, the last play of the game came very close to winning the basketball game, and wanted the ball. But throughout the weight game, we played in spurts. Mm-hmm. You know, we played real well to get a 12-point lead in the first half. And the end of the half, we were not efficient, and it only had a 7-point lead at the end of the half, and then really lost the lead right at the start of the second half. Then came back and played real well. We got some enthusiastic play, some good inside stuff, and then went ahead 64-57 with 4:25 or 26 left. And coming out of a timeout, I thought the biggest shot of the game was the Blukas three-pointer. Mm-hmm. We did not defend it well. If we were going to switch, we did not call the switch. And he was wide open, and it was his only bucket of the game, but it was the biggest one. And it really set the tone for the remaining 4 minutes. I thought we were uncharacteristically tentative. We did not make good decisions, but still were in a position to win the ball game. And then Childress hits a big shot. Mm-hmm. It was definitely a three. At the time, I thought it was a two. I'm not He did, it was a three after looking at tape and whatever, but when that game's going on, it wasn't indicated on the scoreboard. I didn't see an official indicated, although apparently one did indicate it. And in fact, they didn't even post a score until the end of the game. And so it was kind of a bizarre way of ending the game, but you have to give credit to Wake Forest. They really did some great things down the stretch.
You said going into the game you had to stop the points off the dribbler, and they got quite a bit of penetration in that game.
Yeah, we did not defend the ball handler very well. And then when they go in, we needed to really do a better job of making it more physical for him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he just knifed through us so many times. And I think it was a sign that we just didn't play up to par.
Mm-hmm. Okay, there's more straight ahead on Inside Basketball with Duke's Coach K.
Since 1904.
Hard work is the key to a lot of success. Matter of fact, most success. And one young man who has really worked hard on this Blue Devil team in many aspects, Coach, is Eric Meek. Here's a young man that came to you very highly recruited, but right at the end of his senior year, a drunk driver hit him while he was out jogging and just turned his whole athletic, his whole world really upside down.
Well, it certainly did, and it was a tremendous setback. In fact, his high school graduation, when he attended his high school graduation, was in a wheelchair, and it's hard to believe then that a few months after that he was playing basketball for Duke, but he never really got up to being 100% his freshman year, although he did a nice job for us. And then at the end of his freshman year, our physicians looked at his leg again, his calf, and felt that there was a lot of scar tissue in there that needed to be removed. He had gone through physical therapy an awful lot, and you can see on his leg he has a huge incision that shows how much scar tissue was taken out. They only thought there was a little in there, and there was a lot. And really that set up another summer of rehabilitation. And so this past summer was really his first summer to get better.
Mm-hmm.
The other two summers he was trying to catch up to where he had been, and that can be very frustrating, but he has hung in there. He's done a really good job for us, and we had a chance to spend a few minutes talking with him, and I hope you enjoy the piece on Eric.
Has anyone worked harder at improving his game over the past year than Duke center Eric Meek? The 6'10" junior from the San Diego area had a long way to go when he arrived at Duke as a freshman, thanks to a collision with a drunk driver near the end of his senior year in high school. It's taken some time, but now Eric finally feels as though he's able to show what he can do on the basketball court.
This is the closest to 100% I've ever been. My calf has been something where it's taken a long time to bring back to normal because they took so much muscle out of it. My rest of my body feels great, though. My jumping's starting to get back. I feel real strong, and I'm trying to get more confident out there. And I think it's all the work I did in the offseason is finally starting to pay off. I feel real good and trying to make contributions to the team. From the accident that I had, it came at a bad time because when a freshman's coming into college, you have your own things you have to worry about, you know, being a freshman and trying to get through those things. And it really just really doubled it. And it was tough for me to get through. Now it's all about getting my confidence back on the court and doing things that I know I can do out there.
Memories of the accident, the surgery afterward, and the countless hours of rehab have at times clouded that comeback. But with time, Eric has tamed those mental obstacles.
When you have a bad day or something, you just think about it a little bit, but really it's in the past now. I mean, it's time to get on with my life, and I've done a pretty good job about that. I mean, especially with the summer work that I did, it's a thing of the past. And now I'm on stage one where I can continue and go where I can from right now.
Stage one actually began last summer when Eric was selected to play for a team of up-and-coming ACC players on an exhibition tour of Canada. He started at center for the squad, which was coached by Duke assistants Pete Gaudette and Mike Bray, and gained some valuable experience.
Canada was a real good time. got a lot of chance to meet some of the other guys from the ACC, had a great coaching staff, and was able to build my confidence through things that I wasn't able to do last couple of years. So it was a great experience, and it really did a lot for my confidence. Well, they really just wanted me to play and basically try things that I haven't done in the last few years to give me to see what I could do and see what I could do for the team next couple of years. So a lot of different things I worked on, a lot of different things I tried, and it ended up being a real good experience for me altogether.
An avid beachgoer, Eric's summer fun last year also included a lot of unseen work that prepared him not only for Canada, but for this current basketball season.
I did a lot of weightlifting, a lot of playing, a lot of basketball down in San Diego in pickup games. I did some physical therapy with some quickness drills and some things with my calf to keep it flexible, because when I was working on the weights, I didn't want my calf to tighten up. So a lot of therapy and a lot of lifting, a lot of playing, a lot of running. I ended up doing a lot more running this year than I probably have ever done in my life. But it really paid off. It got me in good shape to be able to keep up with all the workouts. It's a great feeling to be out there and playing basketball when you know your body will do more of what you want it to do, as in where last year I wanted to do things that my body just couldn't do.
Eric can be found before and after Duke practices working with Coach Gaudette on his inside game. He's not known as a prolific scorer, but he's intent on becoming one of the team's best rebounders and loves to turn those boards into points. Eric also enjoys the challenge of attacking the glass with the Blue Devils' stable of several talented post players.
That's a good thing about having all the big guys here, is that during practice, you're playing against some players who will really prepare you for when you get out in the court and when you play against other teams. We have so many good big men that when we play these, you know, Sharon Wrights of the league, you know, we're used to playing against, you know, Cherokee Parks. Biggest challenge? Right now, I just like to keep improving.
It's time once again for us to honor our Ronald McDonald Children's Charity Student Athlete of the Week. Each week, the local McDonald owner-operators contribute a portion of their profits for this fund. This week, we honor junior midfielder Nicole Bowler from the Duke field hockey team. She has amassed a 3.86 GPA in the classroom while excelling as a starter on the field. For this, she has been named to the all-academic team for the National Field Hockey Coaches Association. Again, we honor as our Ronald McDonald Children's Charity Student Athlete of the Week, Nicole Bowler.
You can turn the next week for the Blue Devils as State Week, because you play at North Carolina State on Thursday night, and then Florida State comes into Cameron on Saturday. It's an interesting week for you with two ACC games.
Well, we certainly feel that playing at State has always been extremely difficult for us, and the games there, the game last year, of course, was an unbelievable game. Jim Valvano was honored, and what an emotional game that was, and we were fortunate enough to win. And I felt very proud that we won, especially on Jim's day there. Then to come back here and play Florida State, you know, Charlie Ward will be back, and they'll be a whole different team than they have been so far in the ACC season. So we got to pick it up and take advantage of the two games and help put ourselves in better position in this ACC race, Bob.
North Carolina State has struggled so far. They have lost some games that they thought they should have won, and this is a time of upheaval for them.
Yeah, but, you know, in our conference, I've seen teams, and we've gone through that upheaval, and all of a sudden you come up and you play a great game against especially one of your rivals, and especially playing there. Reynolds, they do a great job of supporting their basketball team, and we're going to have to play at our best to beat them.
And what will Charlie Ward make this Florida State team do differently?
I think they'll be more poised. They'll know how to take advantage of their strengths and minimize their weaknesses, and you know, that's what a floor leader does, and that's something our team hasn't done a good job of thus far. or as good a job as we could. Mm-hmm. But Charlie will do that. I mean, that he did that for the football team.
Absolutely. Okay, we hope you'll join us again next week for Inside Basketball with Duke's Coach K.
Hotel facilities and accommodations provided by the Durham Hilton, the official host hotel of the Duke Coaches Show.
This has been Inside Basketball with Duke's Coach K, brought to you by your local Toyota dealer. I love what you do for me, Toyota. By First Union. At First Union, when it comes to service, everything matters. By Gatorade, it's all you're thirsting for. By McDonald's. By S&K Famous Brands. By Nike. By your Carolina Chrysler Plymouth dealer. See your local Carolina Chrysler Plymouth dealer for their best deal today. By Kingsdown, handcrafted mattresses since 1904. And by Payne Weber, we invest in relationships.